act of my hand to fight this battle, you're going to win. And it's not just so that you can go out and be the biggest and the baddest, but because my plans for you are to prosper you. My plans are to call you in this nation ahead in where I've called and destined you to be. Amen. And without this victory right here, we wouldn't be here right now. And to realize that every event that happens in the Bible, if God had not came through for them the way they were, we wouldn't be here right now talking about Israel at all. We'd probably be speaking a whole totally different language, probably serving Baal and Ashtaroth in one form or another right now. Because it's the whoever's God is biggest is who's God is served in the land. Except for those who take their eyes off of that God. Then you have a bunch of gods in the land, and it gets kind of weird. This is sort of Joshua and the Amorites. One side, God is bringing judgment, and obviously they're getting wiped out in battle. But the other side, the Lord is bringing victory. We're taking notes, write that down. Judgment and victory. The Lord brought victory to those who serve Him. He brings success to those who He says, you know what, I've called you to live for me, and if you'll do what I say, I'll give you victory. But you know what? The same place judgment was falling. Repentance could have been there, but it obviously wasn't. But also victory was given. In Egypt, judgment was falling, but provision was given as well. Blessings don't just have to be negative and scary. God can give you some good stuff in those times. Maybe you like it when God provides. Maybe you like it when God gives you victory over something. Maybe they do. It's like, yeah. And that's what I'm talking about, because we can understand these positive signs just as easy as we can understand the negative. Here in Joshua 10, turn to the book of Luke, chapter 23. I'll give you one more. Look at this briefly.
Scratching the surface on going to space, you know, trying to go to Mars. We supposedly went to the moon. That was pretty easy. We've never been back, but anyway. And I could go out on all these other planets and do all these other things. What if he's done this like thousands and thousands of times in other planets with other creation? And he comes and he gives his life for that creation so that you can serve and love them for who they are. I mean, that's what we really want as people, right? We want people to love us because they love us, not because they have to. You know, this isn't North Korea, where you have to or you die. You know, you to put you in a camp. They will torture you, or we'll kill you, or we'll starve you, or do whatever, because you don't do it our way. That's not true love. That's forced submission. And mankind might have to live that way at one place or another, but it doesn't mean they want to. They can say, you know, all hail the king, and we bow to you, when the music starts, and Nebuchadnezzar says, bow, they could bow, but in your heart, you may not have to. I'm doing this to save my life, but I don't do it because of you. You know, we obviously know what the better answer is to not bow and get thrown in the furnace, because that's a whole lot more fun and a lot better story. But we'll just let those guys handle that. Luke chapter 23, verse 44. It says, by this time it was about noon, and darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. This wasn't a few minutes of a solar eclipse like we'll have. I think I heard on one of those videos, it said the longest solar eclipse that's been a total eclipse in one area is like 6 minutes and something, like 6.5 minutes or something. So, you know, the eclipses we have, they don't really last all that long. But here's darkness that falls over the land, not for 3 days, like in Egypt, but for 3 hours. That's pretty significant. Darkness falls across the land until 3 o'clock, and the light from the sun was gone. And suddenly, say suddenly, talked about that last time. The curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. And Jesus shouted and said, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And with these words, he breathed his last. And when the Roman officer overseeing the execution saw what had happened, he worshipped God. And he said, surely this man is innocent. When all the crowd that came to see the crucifixion saw what had happened, they went home in deep sorrow. Your Bible might say they went home and they beat their chest. They went home questioning everything that they thought they had known. Verse 49 says, but Jesus' friends, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching.
That's neat to see that in the midst of darkness in the land, people go home confused, number one. They're like, okay, we didn't expect that. But one of the coolest events that literally changed how God relates to man, why we are able to do this right here, that we're all able to have a Bible in your possession, in your home, on your phone, is because of what happened right here in this moment. That when darkness hit, that temple veil and that curtain was ripped in two, top to bottom. The Holy of Holies was no longer hidden for one. It was open to all. Jesus and the Lord in the midst of eclipses and different stuff can bring judgment. But one of the most beautiful gifts that he's ever given us is that he has provided not just judgment, but access to himself. He said, I can provide for you. I can give you anything you need. I can even give you victory in battles and trials and tribulations you'll go through. But the best gift that I could ever give you is to give you access to me. That you, just like David said, who am I? And you know what? That's still true today. When the manifest presence of God shows up in our lives, that's the first question that comes out of our mouth is, God, who am I? That you would show yourself to me. But it's the very fact, because of what happened right here in Luke 23, is why he shows himself to us. Amen? The curtain was torn in two. And the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin, when they saw this, they ripped their clothes and they screamed in agony because they knew that everything that they stood for and everything that they believed was changed at that very moment. And they were wrong. They were wrong about that man that was on the cross. And I think in their hearts, they probably knew it. But you get filled with evil and different things, and you don't really care. This is the death of Jesus. But in the midst of what judgment comes, there also comes access. People who are even in a place where they have the opportunity to repent, if they will repent, God will grant them access with him again. It's called becoming righteous in God. You come back into right standing with where God wants you to be. He says you're lined back up. Your train's back on the tracks. You haven't derailed. You haven't went off to another track. I've set you back in that right place. And so as this stuff comes into our lives in just a few days, this is the 16th, so we've got 4 days, 5 days. Till this comes on in our area, you can remember this. God, darkness might hit the land for a couple minutes, maybe 4 minutes.
80% dark where we are, so it's still going to be pretty significant. You know, it's, I don't know if that would be like sunset, you know, or right at that verge where it's almost dark, but it's going to be noticeable. And so we definitely encourage you, take note of that wherever you are and see it. You know, it's just going to be for a couple minutes on that side, but it'll be, if you don't have glasses, I don't think I suggest you look at it. I'm tempted to, but I probably better not. I have good eyes, and I don't want to have to go back to glasses. So. But as this comes, remember these things. Remember that, you know what? God can bring judgment, and absolutely He can. We talked about that last week. If judgment comes and all this stuff happens, you know what? 7 years later, from this next week, there will be another eclipse that will come across the other side of the United States. But these eclipses happen every 18 months. A total eclipse happens somewhere on the earth. It just does this. If you ever looked at how the sun sets up in the North Pole, it doesn't set like this. It doesn't go behind the horizon. It does this. It dips like a roller coaster. It doesn't ever go down. It just stays. Like it hits the edge, and it almost gets dark, and it'll get dark a little bit, but then it comes right back up. It just does this. That's a whole other message we'll get into later on. But I might wait for Jesus to tell that one. That's a lot bigger than we probably need to go through. But I think it's doing an eclipse somewhere on the earth all the time. You know, every 18 months or so, one is happening. But everybody's talking about this one. It's happening over the United States. I'm like, are we just that evil and just bad people that the whole world has to pay attention to us? Is it just because Donald Trump's our president? Or do we just think that we're just the bee's knees in everything we do? So everybody has to focus on us. As I said last week with John Maxwell, if you think you're leading, you turn around and nobody's with you, what are you doing? You're going for a walk. You're just by yourself. And I think in America, that's the way it is a lot of time. America's a lot like a teenager, as I'm finding out in my house. Teenagers think the whole world's looking at them all the time. That they're the most important person in the room whenever they step into the room. Amen. A lot of your parents are shaking your head, so you must know. And we've all been there at one point. I remember being a teenager. I thought I was the coolest, most important person. I come in, everybody's looking at me. And I think our country thinks that a lot of times. That because we're a superpower, because we toot our own horn about being a hyperpower now, I don't know. And we just think we're just that big, that the whole world looks at what we do. We are just that big and that influencing to the whole entire world. And I mean, we've got some influence, yeah, but I don't think we're that important, honestly. There's a whole lot of other nations who don't really care for what we do. And if they combine themselves, they're a whole lot bigger and a whole lot stronger than we are, especially with manpower. But that's just how teenagers are. So I guess we can fall into that a little bit. The Lord brings judgment on all three accounts right here, but He also brings access in this final. That's the best gift that He could ever give us. We're God's people. Amen. If you don't want judgment, repent. If you've got sin in your life, get it out. If you're looking at stuff, if you're looking at pornography, if you're cheating on your spouse, if you're texting other people, listen, the smartphone, the technology splits up more relationships and marriages than almost anything in the world today. If that's a vice in your area and you're looking at stuff on it, put it down. Go to a flip phone. Go to no phone. Tell me and I'll buy you strings and cans and we will have our own phone system in Lifeway if that's what needed. That works. Trust me. You know, if there's stuff in your life, we don't have to prophesy that in your life. Oh, thus saith the Lord. You know what that is. And you know what? When eclipses come, that part of that is absolutely true. I don't care if you're saved or not. If the Lord says, I've got stuff that I want you to get out of your life, and here's what it is, then get it out of your life so that you can move on and be the man or woman that God's called you to be. Amen? That's the first and foremost. We can only do that because of Luke 23, because the veil was torn and we're able to have personal access with God. Once you get that out of the way, then you can breathe. Then you can smile. Then you can look people in the eye. Then you can have a life. You don't have to hide stuff. God already knows anyway, but you don't have to hide it from your pastor or hide it from your spouse or hide it from your friends and hope nobody finds out. Everybody knows anyway. We all think we're private. Nothing's private in this world. Everything that you do, say, or talk about is being monitored somewhere. It's not that big of a deal, but yet it is. The Lord brings provision, victory, and access.
during this time, we are in an unprecedented time. Realize in our lifetime, this is the only time that you will see a total solar eclipse. That's it. You get to experience it, and if you, you know, died on Tuesday, you'd be like, hey, I got to see one before I left. How cool is that? We've all probably seen them partially here and there, but it really is a special event. You know, for us right now, it's just over our nation. So enjoy it. If it feels scary and ominous, well, enjoy that too. Be like, ooh, I'm glad I'm not on that side of the world. I'm glad I'm in good graces with God. I'm thankful that I have Him and I have access in all that I do. Amen? And that changes it. That lets you know who you really are, that you are, as the Bible says, His beloved, and He is yours. He loves you more than you could even compare or ask. But you know what? You're just as much of a treasure to Him as He is to you. And that's amazing. That's one of the cool things in that movie that they were saying. They were all trying to present like God, and they said, you know, we're so excited with what you do. And we could know all, but we choose to hear it like it's for the first time. That's so cool. Because I really think God's that way. I really think He loves us to be like, tell me about your day. Tell me. And you're like, no, you don't want to hear it. You already know these things. He's like, no, tell me. Let's talk about it. Let's do these things. You know, share your life with me. You know, and we said that in here. You know, if we're at God's ant farm, well, even ant farms are cool. Amen? If you have a pet, yeah, they're your pet. And they literally survive because of your good graces in their life. If you don't feed them, they'll die. If you don't give them water, they'll die. But they're also a joy to just look at. They're a joy to interact with your life. Amen? It has to come from somewhere. So, in closing, Psalm 91, verse 1 and 2. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. In the shadow of who God is, could He bring provision? Could He bring victory? Could He bring access to who you are, to where you're at, to bring you to a new level, to a new place? And that if you do that and you find rest in His shadow, let's say in that solar eclipse shadow, if you want to go that route, if you can find rest in the shadow of who He is, realize it in the Bible when it talks about the sun and the moon, the sun a lot of times will represent the Gentiles and the nations of the world, but the moon represents the church. Represents us. And sometimes you can really only see what's going on around the world whenever you can get the church in full view in front of it to say, that's what's going on. That's where we need to go. That's the direction. Those things work together. It's not just us against them. You know, it's me against the world. No, it's not. You're here because of the world. You're here to be an extension to the world to say, God loves me. He loves you. He can bring the same things into your life as well. Amen. So to find that, and to find that rest, and to find that shelter can be the difference between a happy life. You know that phrase, happy wife, happy what? That's bull. Don't believe that. Your wife doesn't run that house. You do. You're the man. Amen. Act like it. Live like it. It's not let that wife just let them do what they want. No, they don't want that. They want you to lead the home. So lead the home. But lead it with them beside you to say, babe, what do you think? Let's do this together. You know, it's a lot more fun if we're walking beside each other. If we're walking holding hands, and just walking beside each other, or walking and put your arm out and put your arm through it, that's a whole lot more fun to walk out of somewhere. Amen. And just to walk that way, you know, just walking beside each other like two monkeys. That's no fun. Grab hands like two monkeys and walk. Enjoy life together. That's how God wants. He wants us to tell me about your life. Let's crisscross our arms and let's talk about something. Let me see what you're really about. Show me those things. Because at the end of this thing, we've got victory. And this eclipse next week will just be a shadow to hopefully remind you of that. You know what? In God, I've got the victory. I can do whatever I need to do because God has called me to this place. He's called me in this area. And I'm telling you, this year's going to be a great year. We're going to wrap this thing up. We're going to be in 18 just real quick. And this fall is going to be some amazing things happen. August 21st is coming. So is September 23rd. There's a whole lot of cool stuff going to happen on the other side of this pond. So we'll get into that as we get closer. Amen?
Bow your heads with me. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, we honor you in this house. We thank you for your word. It's just so cool that even this, the smallest events that could go on, even events that would happen once in our lifetime, we can find you in the word that can apply to it. You're so amazing. So we thank you for all that you've spoken to us tonight. Lord, we do pray for any areas within us that maybe there's sin, maybe there's situations, maybe there's strongholds or addictions. Lord, whatever that is, Lord, we bring that up and we lay that before you right now. Lord, we ask for forgiveness. More than that, we just confess our sin and repent of those things. Because we know that when that happens, Lord, our lives are put back in right standing with you. So we thank you. Lord, we thank you for all that you are doing in our lives and in this church. We pray for this moment next week that it would change us, that we could remember that we're in the shadow of your victory in our lives. And may it bring provision. May it bring victory. May it bring access. May this mic go away in Jesus' name. We love you. We thank you for it all. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, get me out of here. We love you. You're dismissed. I'm taking this mic off. We'll see you tomorrow night for prayer, 7 o'clock.